In the election, not only do we have the good news that Joe Biden has apparently won, but there was other good news as well, some of which we've mentioned, but we wanted to give you a quick little roundup of the good things that are happening below the level that a lot of people are focusing on, which is the presidential election. So as many people know, Florida passed a minimum wage increase of $15 an hour, but you also have Portland, Maine passing minimum wage increases, which is absolutely awesome. Now for some of those workers, it is gonna take a few years for that to come in, but that is a significant improvement to the quality of life of literally millions of people in those states, and that should not be missed. And thank you to the organizers, Fight for 15 and DSA and a lot of other great organizers in those states that have done that. That is a very significant win of the most important kind.
Yeah, you remember that in your messaging. And this is one of those things where like there's two ways to look at it, and both are worthwhile. One is people like wage hikes.
Yeah.
They like making more money, especially hourly. Hourly is such a freaking like, when you're doing it, they have quantified how much time I've been hourly, I've been salary. And salary, you're like, all right, I know how much I'm making. Everything else is around the, I'll try to find other ways to make money. With hourly, you're just like, I have to work more hours. And it gets to you, it gets you. If they're not guaranteed, it gets to you.
Yeah.
And things to countervail that or counteract that are making more money every hour in guaranteeing that, and people like it. And then the other thing is there have been plenty of politicians who have lost, who profess themselves to be $15 or higher wage candidates, but who lose in the same election that a one issue proposition for that is on the table.
Yeah.
And what that proved to me is that people don't trust politicians.
Yeah.
They don't like them. There's too much extra baggage. And what you need to do is to message, no, I am just for those issues. Mm-hmm. Vote for me on those issues because they're not.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that'll be a successful winning strategy, I think, for AOC. Yeah. And you remember way back in 2016 when Trump was asked about wages in a debate, he twice said that they're too high. How was that not in ads? Like just play him saying the wages are too high and then have the narrator ask, do you think your wages are too high? Donald Trump does. That wasn't an ad. In two candidacies, it wasn't an ad. I know it's not everything, it's not the solution to everything, but I think that seems pretty good to run in a state where 60% are saying minimum wage workers need higher wages. And by the way, 60% of Florida isn't on minimum wage. That is tons of people who make more than minimum wage saying, I think they should make higher wages. This is clearly, I think, a message that could win.
And I think something that helps you in states like that, Maine is one of them. Mm-hmm. Plenty of times the people of Maine on referenda have said, this is what I want, beyond the shadow of a doubt.
Yeah.
And in Florida as well. In Maine, it was ranked choice voting and they had to do it twice because the legislature was like, no, please.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
And then in Florida, it was people who have basically repaid their debt to society. Can they vote now? And by a supermajority, again, it was voted for. And the Republican state legislature was like, nah, that's not gonna work for me.
Yeah.
And they said no.
Yeah. Love it when
so
the legislature
vow to uphold, vow to vote yes. And tell people that, like, listen, the same reason you're voting for this as a referendum, as instead of just trusting that your politicians will make this stuff happen for you, is the same reason you should vote against your existing state politician, because they're lying. They just want you to think that they got your best interests at heart, when really we now have them on record undoing what you told them to do.
Yeah. Okay, I'm gonna run down a few other awesome things that happened around the country. Oregon became the first state to decriminalize drug possession. Not marijuana possession, drug possession, like all of them. Doesn't mean it's legalizing everything, but it is decriminalizing all of those drugs. Colorado voters rejected a 22-week abortion ban. Colorado voters approved a paid family leave program. Two awesome ones for Colorado. California approved a ballot measure that will allow formerly incarcerated people on parole to vote, which is great for some reason. At the same time, people saying people on parole should be able to vote didn't think that people who are gonna be 18 for a general election should be able to vote at 17 for the primary that will produce candidates for that. I don't understand
it's
why.
So weird.
It's such a so weird. Weird. How is that not a slam? Yeah, you know what? No, I don't want 17-year-olds in my primary. What? I mean, I guess that's the fear that some centrists have, that they would vote overwhelmingly for progressives, but they're still 17-year-olds. They would literally be the least turnout group in any of those elections, and still people didn't want to give it to them. But they did give it to people on formerly incarcerated people on parole, which is good. And in addition to Oregon, which decriminalized all drug possession, Arizona, New Jersey, South Dakota, and Montana all voted to legalize recreational marijuana. And think about what that means, that America will have been slower to do something on average that South Dakota and Montana managed in terms of legalization.
Man, go to those states. Those states are, well, I haven't been to any of them, but I've been to Vermont and it is a trip, dude.
Yeah.
I'm talking about people who hunt high. That's all I'm saying.
Oh,
John.
My God. Don't
people
hunt
get high and go hunting. I went to Vermont and on like this weird thing. Hopefully it's still around for Rotten Tomatoes show. We did like a river runs through it, Blu-ray release junket. And the people who worked at this place that they had the junket at were awesome. They're like, listen, I go hunting and I'm high. I'm in a treehouse playing Xbox until I hear a deer and then I pause it and I never get the deer. But it's fun.
That does sound
just
fun.
Think of it, there's a lot of ways to be that are totally fine that that might be different than what you think they are.
Exactly, so exactly. Trip, and man. With that as the transition, there were also great wins across the country for LGBTQIA plus candidates, including Sarah McBride made headlines when she became the first openly transgender state senator and highest ranking transgender official in the country. Awesome there. You have Stephanie Byers will become Kansas's first ever openly transgender elected official, and Vermont elected its first openly transgender candidate, Taylor Smalls, to the state legislature. So multiple victories there. Breonna Tatone, Colorado's first openly transgender legislator, was also reelected, and Lisa Bunker was reelected in her post as representative for New Hampshire. All of that news causing virtually every right wing blowhard's head to explode. Because this is a topic that they think about more than literally anything else while having no understanding whatsoever. In addition, you have Mondaire Jones and Richie Torres becoming the first openly gay black men elected to Congress in New York. Michelle Rayner Goolsbee became the first openly queer black woman elected to Florida's House of Representatives. Kim Jackson was elected as state senator in Georgia, the first openly queer candidate to do so. And Tori Harris became the first LGBTQ plus member of Tennessee's state legislature. So a lot of these are at the state level, but a lot of progress and representation coming out of Tuesday.
Yeah. And if you're upset with that, I'm sorry. Like, this is, and I will say that a lot, like, being cool with this is actually at the center of a lot of your all's argument as well. You just don't know it.
Yeah.
Like, people who are opposed to this, it's like, so what about what who they are is wrong? Nothing.
Nothing.
Shouldn't you just let them be and let them do what they do? Shouldn't it be based on like what they actually enact and how they conduct their business, not who they are? I don't see a valid argument against. So exactly. Good for everybody.
Yeah, and one is not being provided.
And just a last thing is like the normalization. Like, why would you not want to normalize this? And it's so good. Just make it normal. Yeah. I'm tired of hearing about it. Well, if there's enough people like this in Congress, you won't hear about it because it won't be special anymore.
Yeah,
you'll be the only special one.
Yeah. And bear in mind, I made a reference there to the fact that, you know, like a Ben Shapiro or a Matt Walsh, all of them talk constantly demonizing the trans community. But it's not just them. You have any number of state legislatures trying to pass laws discriminating against the community, but it's also not just them. You remember in 2016, you know, a million years ago, just in 2016, Ted Cruz, who came second in the Republican primary, one of his final campaign ads before he pulled out was an ad demonizing trans individuals for wanting to have rights to go to the bathrooms of, you know, based on their identification, talking about men pretending to be women who are gonna be a threat to your daughters. That was Ted Cruz, incredibly powerful Republican senator still, who came in second and is almost certainly gonna run for president again. That is as high profile effectively as it gets. So don't forget, the discrimination is rampant, it is high level. And so great to see this increased representation around the country. Now,
John, just a question for you. Do you think from a scientific perspective, the reason that Ted Cruz and all those like right wing media personalities you mentioned, the reason, do you think scientifically the reason they're so opposed to the trans community and the gay community and lesbian community is because of all the boners that they get from that?
I'm too dizzy to deal right now. I think my serious non-jokey answer is that I think they wish that they could openly demonize gay individuals the way that they could up until just a couple of years ago. And I think that they're reading the room and saying, we gotta be a little bit more careful about that. But the trans community, it's still safe to attack them. And so I think that's why they're doing that. I think it is opportunistic, awful and evil, and I think that we need to be very clear about that.
Okay, like just I'm gonna pass out any second. Pragmatic approach. The last thing, the pragmatic approach is like all like much like my position on the drug issue. It's like all the like if there's someone pretending to be a woman so they can get in the women's bathroom and they sexually assault someone, the sexual assault is still illegal. Yeah. Like if someone gets high and then robs a store or something. Or robs a store to pay for their meth addiction. Like,
yeah,
the robbery is still illegal.
Yeah, it is.
So there still is law and order.
It is irrational, clearly. Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.